Hello and welcome. I'm Amritanshu Rai and you're watching Law of the Land on Raj Sabha TV. Today we bring to you the Communal Violence Bill, which after several rounds of deliberation has now been named Prevention of Communal and Targeted Violence Bill 2011 by the National Advisory Council. The draft proposal seeks to prevent targeted violence against religious and linguistic minority. To discuss the issue, I have with me Mr. N.C. Saxena, member, National Advisory Council, and Mr. Sanjay Parekh, advocate in the Supreme Court. Now for the headlines. The draft proposed by the National Advisory Council prevents communal and targeted violence. The draft bill seeks to empower central government to declare a state disturbed under Article 355 of the Constitution. First version of the Communal Violence Bill was introduced in the Raj Sabha in 2005, but consensus evades the bill. After encountering hurdles, the Communal Violence Bill 2005 has been redrafted by the National Advisory Council and is now known as Prevention of Communal and Targeted Violence Bill 2011. The proposed bill empowers the central government to declare any state as being disturbed. The bill seeks to protect the religious and linguistic minorities as well as scheduled caste and scheduled tribes.
The proposed draft provides for a wider definition of communal and targeted violence. The draft bill seeks to cover only such violence which destroys the secular fabric of the nation. It also provides for the protection of minority groups against any such offenses. The bill seeks to set up a national authority for communal harmony at the center and state authority in the states. The authority will be responsible for justice and reparation of communal violence. The public servants are made directly answerable to the national authority. The proposed bill has vested more powers in the state machinery by equating communal violence with internal disturbance.
We need to be very, very respectful of the federal principle in this country. It would be a little, impractical for us to imagine that, you know, when bills like the NCTC, the Lokpal are getting stuck on the federal principle, if the anti-communal violence bill is going to try and trespass the federal authorities, we are going to get this bill through.
Bombay riots and Gujarat riots are two of the worst cases of riots in the recent past. Let's look at some of the statistics relating to communal violence. The death toll in Mumbai riots was 1,788. About 1,000 people were killed in Gujarat riots. According to the Home Ministry data, between 2001 and 2009, 6,541 communal clashes occurred in which 2,234 persons lost their lives.
All communal violence in India, the 84 riots, the Bhagalpur violence, all of them have been surrounded by enormous impunity, which is, impunity means that you can commit a crime, and people, victims have actually said this to me, that if one person kills another person in a closed room, there's much less chance that 100 people are killed. I kill 100 people in front of 1,000 people, there's much less chance that I will be punished as compared to that one person who's killed one person without any witnesses.
The bill was redrafted by the National Advisory Council headed by UPA Chairperson Sonia Gandhi. The bill has been drafted in close coordination with several NGOs, human rights activists and legal experts. The provision to declare any state disturbed makes the bill highly controversial. It was outrightly rejected by almost all the parties on the ground that it will centralize too much power on the state machinery. With reporter Ravinder Singh Shoran, Reshma Roy, Rajya Sabha TV.
The bill proposes that where it is shown that continuing unlawful activity of a widespread or systematic nature has occurred, it could be reasonably presumed that the public servant charged with the duty to prevent communal and targeted violence has failed to act and will thus be pulled up. My question to you, Mr. Saxena, is, do you think it is proper, even at a proposal stage, to allow the bureaucracy, which is actually the bedrock of the entire execution system, to be pressurized to such a limit that for every step, whether it be dereliction, whether it be not acting, whether it be behaving in a certain manner, he should be pulled up?
Well, the experience so far is that in case of linguistic and religious minorities, which could be Biharis in Maharashtra or Tamilians in Karnataka or Muslims in many states, police and local administration do not act in an unbiased manner. Okay. The purpose of NAC's draft is to enhance their accountability, is to make them act in a manner which will provide protection to minorities, which will control violence as early as possible. Of course, the national authority has no power to take action against them. It can only recommend, and the provisions of law in CRPC which provide protection to the officers even when they are found to be guilty of dereliction of duty, that is proposed to be changed, and therefore they would not be able to, state government's permission will not be necessary if they are found guilty of abdication of their responsibilities.
I'll bring in Mr. Parik. Mr. Parik, the way you must have read the whole thing, the way it appears, do you feel or do you get a feeling that it will go out and achieve what it actually tries to achieve?
There should be some kind of a mechanism by which accountability is imposed on them, general accountability. But when you see this massive kind of violation which had taken place in Bombay, Gujarat and other places, then the question which appears is, which really all of us are concerned, is whether there should be a special law to deal with the officials and even those who are in charge of rule of law, and action should be taken against them. Now, this particular bill fixes the accountability. Mm-hmm. And certain circumstances...
Will it help?
No, certain circumstances, I think enforcing accountability is something which is very, very necessary. Otherwise, what happens is that some inaction or wrong action by the authorities, it goes unpunished and nothing happens. And then with the investigation and the trial, etc., takes place, but no action is taken against those people. This brings an accountability which is required now, present times.
I'll bring Mr. Saxena. And Mr. Saxena, on the federal structure bit, that is one reason why the earlier proposals or earlier all the proposed drafts could not acquire the consensus that it required. On that front, how well do you think does this, on that benchmark, does this bill stand?
Well, the power to take action against officials who are found to be guilty would still be with the state government and the courts. Government of India cannot punish them. Government of India can only say that this kind of discrimination has taken place. In fact, you should also look at, of course, Gujarat is, I think, to some extent an exception. If you look at other cases of violence, take, for instance, violence against Bihari taxi drivers in Mumbai, Maharashtra. One found that the local administration was not taking action because they were immigrants, because they had no political clout. They were a non-dominant group. If you go back 20, 30 years back, there are many commission reports which have clearly said that the police has acted in a very discriminatory manner.
I agree, Mr. Saxena. The point you've, but the question that I wanted to address was, on the federal structure benchmark, does this proposed bill meet that benchmark, or there are going to be issues? Well, I'll bring in Mr. Parik on
no,
that.
No, in fact, let me just say that if the state governments were also totally committed to maintaining law and order, if they had no political bias against immigrants or against minorities, there would have been no problem. But the experience shows that often state governments have turned a blind eye to what is going on in their under their administration, and therefore there is a need for a central authority to point out what is going on in their district.
Does it stand on the
benchmark? The federal principle, certain issues which are covered by this bill, they are in concurrent list. So like CRPC, etc., you can make certain changes in it.
And in IPC also, suppose you make these are special offences. So therefore, the central government will have power to legislate. But basically, law and order is a state subject. So there is going to be some problem. But once you look at it, the problem that this is something which is exceptional in nature.
And special and need legislation need, requires.
Special need is required. In those situations, one, like terrorism, for example, the all-terrorist thing, though we have been saying so many things about it, but the justification which has been given by the Supreme Court is, this is a special kind of a thing. It is not normal law and order situation. Therefore, the central government is justifiable in bringing this law.
Okay. On that note, it's time for us to head into a break. When we come back, we will talk about first bill on communal violence, which was tabled in Parliament. Welcome back. The Communal Violence Bill was introduced in Rajya Sabha in 2005. Let's look at some of the provisions of the old bill, which is yet to be passed. The bill seeks to empower central government to intervene into the functioning of the state government to prevent and control communal violence, which threatens to violate the secular fabric, unity, integrity, and internal security.
The way the state government handled the Gujarat riots in 2002 raised questions on the role of the state. The Supreme Court questioned the manner in which the state acted. The National Human Rights Commission had similar observations. Several non-government organizations protested. A need was felt to legislate on the matter. The government proposed the Communal Violence Bill in 2005 to prevent and control such incidents and take other necessary steps.
2005 bill actually gives greater power to the state and its authorities in a situation of communal violence. All narratives and analysis of communal violence will show that the riot is fueled and further engineered and orchestrated by those sitting in state authority. If you are going to give them more power, you are only going to see more innocent people dying.
Communal violence ka matlab ye hai ki agar kisi shakhs ko के ऊपर अटैक किया जाए इस वजह से कि उसका एक किसी पर्टिकुलर ग्रुप से ताल्लुक है और उस ग्रुप को डिफाइन किया गया है सेक्शन 3E के अंडर में और उसमें ये कहा गया है कि ग्रुप का मतलब है कि अगर वो किसी स्टेट के अंदर जो माइनॉरिटी है उस माइनॉरिटी से ताल्लुक रखता हो या वो दलित समाज से ताल्लुक रखता हो तो उसे कम्युनल वायलेंस माना जाएगा.
The bill seeks to provide for declaration of certain areas as communally disturbed areas by the state government. It also lays down measures for prevention of acts leading to communal violence. It seeks to enhance punishments for offences relating to communal violence. The bill provides speedy investigation and trial of offences through special courts. It creates institutional mechanism for relief and rehabilitation measures for victims. It makes provisions for compensation to the victims and provides for special powers to the central government in certain areas.
This kind of targeted, systematic, brutal attack cannot take place until and unless there is some amount of overt or covert collusion with the state and its agencies. Therefore, who has to be reined in and who has to be punished? Are the public servants, those who are in positions of civil and political authority. What we need to do is to take away the impunity that is enjoyed by the public servant.
It's been 10 years and the trials on Gujarat case is still on. There has been no such law, no such bill to prove as an effective deterrent against communal violence in India. The bill was criticized by the opposition and allies on several grounds. It was tabled in the upper house of the parliament in 2005. So far, it has witnessed 80 amendments and is still not in position to go through as expected. The 2009 version of the bill found itself in troubled waters due to increased concentration of power in central government's hand. Now the National Advisory Council has redrafted the bill.
The earlier bills and amendments had empowered the centre to the extent that it could intervene directly in the affairs of the state government and prevent communal violence. But these one-sided powers have now been reduced. My question to you, Mr. Parikh, on the better part of the bill, which is what really needs to be highlighted, is the rehabilitation, the reparation bit. What is it? how do you feel and stand? Does it really manage to do justice?
See, prevention by different kind of means, which is again a state subject. It's not as if something happens, then you have to take action. But you must all the time see that any hatred which is being generated, any adverse atmosphere which is being created, that is neutralized by the state machinery. Mm-hmm. This is the preventive part which should be there. Then the second very important thing is relief which has been given to the victims. In all these cases, we have seen people who suffer, they don't get proper water, drinking water, then food, medicine, etc. Compensation is a different thing. Compensation, they have to go to the court and then languish there for years together. This is something which is immediately required, and this is being fulfilled by this particular bill. I think on this, there should not be any kind of political dissension by any of the political parties. This is something which is a humanitarian nature. They are not committed anything wrong, whether they are Muslims or Hindus or any caste or any
linguistic
creed,
minority.
Anything. They should be, actually, this is required to be done in a way which has been provided in this.
The
way.
Entire proposed draft, at the end of it, extensive calibration, pinpointed, focused compensation on losing of an arm, on losing of a leg, everything calculated, calibrated, and compensation accordingly fixed. Do you think this is the way it should happen, or should it be a little more flexible so that it can adapt according to the changing times? Because expenses are not decreasing. If you lock it in and place it the way it is in the compensation form and make it part of the bill, then it is very difficult to manage it later.
It should be minimal.
Well, in fact, this is only a draft. And when a bill is prepared by a government, I'm sure that they will put the rate of compensation in a schedule so that it can easily be amended without going to parliament again, and it can be amended. The main point here is that in many cases of violence, we find that although majority of people who are killed or injured or arrested are from the minority community, but there may be some from the majority community who is also hit or injured or even killed. Therefore, it is very important that when we are organizing relief camps or when we are organizing or giving compensation, it should be irrespective of whether they are majority and minority. Let me just give you some figures. If you look at the Ranchi riots of 1967, 20 Hindus and 156 Muslims were killed. In the Muradabad riots of 1980, 18 Hindus and 142 Muslims were killed. So there is bias on both sides. I'm not saying that there is bias only from majority to minority, but equal bias does unequal harm. And the harm done to minority is several times as compared to the harm done to the majority. However, when it comes to compensation or relief, government should be very liberal and have it for every person.
Yeah, point you were making.
I wish to add something, because as far as the victims are concerned, I think when we see equal protection of law and without any discrimination, then the Hindus, Muslims, or nothing should come at all. They have all suffered, and they should get all protections. As far as the compensation amount is concerned, we have in motor vehicle, you know, then how it has to be done. Yeah. So that formula can be adopted, but it is necessary that person should be immediately paid within a given time, say within 2 weeks within a week's time, some minimum compensation and the other
but
amount.
But there are no timelines.
That should be done. I know.
There are no timelines.
This has to be there because immediately you require some financial support, which should be given without any kind of going into other, like we say, you know, the injury which has occurred, that you can do later.
Assessment can happen later. Yeah. On that note, it's time for us to head into a break. When we come back, we'll show you an interview with civil rights activist Shabnam Hashmi. Welcome back. My colleague Reshma Roy spoke to Shabnam Hashmi, civil rights activist, and tried to get her point of view.
Do you think the 2005 bill or the draft presented by NSC will be an effective deterrent?
The government had picked up clauses from different, some from POTA, some from Armed Forces Special Powers Act, and put it together. It was not a bill at all, having special, you know, declaring an area as a disturbed area. The kind of communal violence which is taking place in India today, it is not, all the communal violence is not like 2002 Gujarat. The draft which came out suddenly had the, you know, introduction of the disturbed area again. And there was again a huge hangama over it. But the present bill, one, it has a huge authority, which is supposed to take over the charge from the administration.
The bills since 2005 have been amended quite a few times. Where do you think all those amendments have gone wrong?
The most important thing in a bill is to have accountability for the public servant, whether it is the DM or the SP or the Home Secretary or the Chief Minister. Because as of now, there is no such law which is existing in India, which holds them responsible for not curbing violence. One is that there are communal forces themselves who do not want such a bill. Because if a bill comes into action which is curbing the communal violence, then the politics of a number of political parties would come to an end, because they survive on that. So they are the first ones to make hangama over it.
What provisions do you think should be included in an effective communal violence bill?
See, a bill is required which is strong enough to curb communal violence. A bill is required where communal violence can actually be stopped in practice and not only on paper. The bill, this present NAC bill, has some very good clauses on relief and rehabilitation, which are welcome and which should be included in the final bill.
The draft bill prepared by NAC proposes that any public servant in command of security forces fails to exercise control over persons under his or her command, and as a result of such failure, offences under the acts are committed, then the public servant shall be guilty of the offence of breach of command responsibility. Well, there are many clauses which rein in the public servant, superior officer and so on, which is an advancement in the legal framework. But the point is the structure of the bill, the point that you wanted to bring in relating to the structure of the bill.
See, what happens is that when we do the drafting, look at the Criminal Procedure Code, now some amendments have been made, look at the Indian Penal Code, look at some of the old enactments which have been drafted in a concise way. Now, if you look at this particular, it runs into about, the print is about 50-60 pages. And then there are so many things which are actually loose ends are there. If you look at, for example, some definitions which have been made here, hostile environment against a group, deprive or threaten, deprive such a person of his fundamental rights, etc. Now, it's such a vast kind of a thing,
broad.
That I'm very, very, very broad. Then different parts which are there, one can understand that reparation and the compensation part is there. For example, see, you can always bring in the one example which has been given, that for protecting the fundamental rights, whether you need civil liberties differently, you need, other parts of fundamental rights.
Yeah.
Rights, a different kind of an institution. The question is that some of these things probably have to be worked on a little bit more to make it concise. It is too broad a thing, and implementation becomes even the national
It is just at a draft stage. NSC has just reworked on it,
okay,
and has now brought out a paper which
this
is there on the website.
I think the structure
is... We've taken it up at this juncture, but I'm sure there's a lot of... In fact, it has been 10 years, and we still don't have a bill. The first 2002... is what prompted, 2002 Gujarat riots is what prompted this entire exercise.
Yeah.
And we still don't have it. We are 10 years ahead of that, and there is still no legislation. But I'll bring in Mr. Saxena on that. Several laws, several clauses, several aspects, don't do this, do this, this is how you talk, this is how you behave, this is how you'll be punished, this is how you'll not be punished, this is how you can get bail, this is how you can go to the judiciary, this is how you can appeal. Eventually, the implementation execution is just in the hands of the virtually thousands of bureaucrats that we have in this country. Do you think it's easy to implement all this by the same set of people? And especially if you're bringing in such a proposal, what about the training aspect? I mean, half of it can be taken care of if the Lal Bahadur Shastri Academy builds in a system and prepares the bureaucrats in advance.
Yeah. Well, in fact, you're very right that the main problem as regards communal violence is the widespread prejudice and bias which exists in the administration and in the police especially. There are cases when the PAC in UP, in Meerut, for instance, in 1982, they entered into Muslim localities and started firing indiscriminately. Again, because no action was taken against them, in 1989, the PAC became bolder. Mm-hmm. They took police and they took Muslims in a truck, took them to Jamuna and asked them to get down and shut, like this, hundreds of Muslim innocent people were killed. So the idea is that in addition to having deterrent laws, you must also think of how to change the mindset. And that can happen only, not only through training. And training should be in these training, case study should be prepared by police officers themselves, and which will show how police acted in a biased manner. Because generally it is seen, if you have a case study written by an academic, police people will have all kinds of doubts.
Credibility.
But credibility question comes in. You also should examine our own textbooks and see whether our textbooks are promoting some kind
of hugely controversial.
I'll tell you,
huge exercise. Almost impossible.
I'll just give an example. In UP, at one point of time, there was a chapter on Abdul Hamid. Abdul Hamid was a soldier who died in 65 war against Pakistan. Full of praise for Abdul Hamid. But there was a sentence. Abdul Hamid Musliman tha, lekin phir bhi desh bhakt tha.
On that note, thank you, sir, for joining us on this discussion. It's time for us to end the show. You can email your suggestions and comments to law.rstv@gmail.com. You can also watch our shows on the YouTube. We'll be back with a new issue and a new episode. Keep watching Rajya Sabha TV.